What's up, Define Nation, and welcome to another episode of Define Your Health with Danielle Giordano, strength through knowledge. And you guys know that I'm very passionate about knowledge. And once you have knowledge, knowledge truly is power that empowers people. And today I am so happy to have a very special guest with me. We are definitely going to be talking about how to empower folks that might be in situations that they find themselves feeling vulnerable or just really not all that great. Very, as we say, sticky situations. And, you know, we're doing this follow-up show because of the response we got from a show that we aired about a month ago. Some of you may remember Renee Baker, who is a licensed certified therapist, and she was really talking about kind of the struggles that people go through and how they deal with things emotionally or the lack of dealing with things emotionally. And we had a lot of really great questions that were posted on our social media sites about that and people who sent in emails, and just there was a lot of reaction to what she had to say. And so I wanted to follow up with our very special guest today, Lisa Zahn, who is a board certified family law attorney. As a matter of fact, Lisa, you were named the best lawyer in America.
That's true.
In America. Not just in 2011, not just in 2012, not in 13, 14, but also this year in 15, and 2016 was just announced, and you made that list as well.
Yeah,
we're
so
right in our backyard. As a matter of fact, D Magazine recognized you as well, too. Speaking of our backyard, you were named one of their super lawyers in Dallas in D Magazine, and she has such a calming voice. She's such the opposite. You know, I'm all energetic and, all electric, like I swallowed a battery. I'm not sure. And she's all like, okay, let's just relax, and this is good. So many of you will see a difference today, maybe. Maybe you can calm me down.
We'll see.
Maybe. Okay. That's a tough follow. So, Define Nation, you know, one of the things that many of you knew is, you know, I was in an abusive relationship at one point in my life, and it's very difficult. It's extremely difficult to come out of that situation. Now, fortunately, I was not in a situation where I was married. And I don't know about the rest of our listeners, but typically, Lisa, when I think family law, I think divorce. And I don't mean to sound negative when I say that, but that's the first thing that comes to my mind. Are divorce cases typically the largest cases you handle in volume? Or
yes, they are. And I wanted to comment on something you said about being in an abusive relationship, and you said, unfortunately, you weren't married. If you had known or had counsel then, you could have gotten a protective order, because when you're in a dating relationship with somebody, by law, if there is abuse going on, you can get a protective order protecting you from that person.
I did not know that.
Once the protective order is issued, it's a felony offense if a person's convicted of violating the protective order. So it has teeth. It's a good vehicle if somebody's in an abusive relationship.
Wow, and there's your first tip of the show, Define Nation. I did not know that. I thought it was, okay, very, very good. Well, and, you know, it seems like, and I think you had mentioned to me once before, that most of the times when people come to you, they are in situations where they're really at a very low point emotionally, physically. Many times finances play into the whole scenario and the situation. Can you tell us just a little bit kind of what you see and how you initially deal with that?
Well, it's not just divorce. In any kind of lawsuit, people are vulnerable. They're at their lowest when they're, especially in a family law case. It might be a divorce. It might be a child custody case. Could be a protective order case or grandparent access. But what I do involves families when things aren't going right. They're not going well at all. And people are down. They are usually emotionally, financially, and physically just drained. And they've hit a wall. And they need, so how I deal with that is I encourage almost everyone I see, all of my clients, to get counseling, not because I think there's something wrong with them. It's because I think there's something right with them, mm-hmm. and they need the extra support. When you're going through a lawsuit, it's hard enough without all the other factors that come into play, like the end of a marriage. That's like death to many people. Mm-hmm. So they need the support of counseling. If people are also willing to go out and exercise, eat well, and just treat themselves really well, that helps them so much, and it helps me help them better.
So really, I mean, it seems to me, too, that along with you know, obviously from all your accolades that you've been able to rack over the years, you really need to have a very compassionate side, or at least, I mean, when clients initially come to you, I'm sure there's a, I don't want to use the word hand-holding, but I'm sure there's kind of a period of adjustment that
you can use that word.
To be more, I can't, okay. Yeah. That there needs to be more, there just needs to be more compassion, and there needs to be more of understanding, I guess is what I'm trying to say. Do you also find that as well?
I believe that to be very true. Many lawyers won't have anything to do with family law because they don't like the emotions, they don't like the hand-holding, and it's messy. And that's okay with me. I do messy very well. people have feelings, they have emotions, and that's just part of human nature, and it comes with the territory.
Wow. Well, Lisa, I tell you what, we are going to get right into some statistics and also some quantitative steps that people can take as soon as we come back from this commercial break. Remember, Define Nation, this segment brought to you by SoyJoy, the natural snack bars made with plant-based protein and real fruit. SoyJoy helps fuel your day, so grab some today when you're at the store. Delicious energy is waiting for you at SoyJoy.com. That's us.soyjoy.com. Hey, Define Nation, this is Danielle from the Define Your Health Strength Through Knowledge radio show. And when I chose the gear I would use during the Highway for Health cycling project, I chose only the best. And that meant I chose Primal for my cycling apparel. Their quality is simply unmatched by anyone in the industry. And the creative design geniuses are innovative engineers. For your next team event or local riding group jerseys, check out my Primal friends at primalwear.com. That's PRIMALwear.com.
Hello, I'm Marie Lascaritas, founder and president of the Alzheimer's Cure Foundation. Our mission and vision is to dramatically accelerate the cure for this devastating disease by raising and awarding a $20 million cash prize that will serve as the gold medal for the scientists or team of scientists to discover the cure. We need everyone's help. We need all donations, big and small. Our website is www.ALZ.org. You can donate through our website. You can also call me at area code 401-473-7019. We need your help. All donations, big and small.
And we are back to Find Nation with our special guest, Lisa Zahn, who is a board-certified family law lawyer. One of the best in America, definitely. Cherry for everybody's top here in Dallas as a super lawyer. I like that, super lawyer. And you know, we were kind of talking about some serious stuff coming out of the last segment, and just I want to really dig more into that. When you were talking about restraining orders and what, you know, steps you can take to protect yourself, really, you know, one statistic that really stood out at me is I found one in particular that women 16 to 24 have the highest rates of violence against them. Now, typically, a 16 or 17-year-old is not in a marriage situation. So that would be something that would definitely come into play, what you had just mentioned before we went to break.
Yeah, a dating relationship in which you could get a protective order. And I want to touch on something just for clarification. You mentioned a temporary restraining order. That's a different animal than a protective order.
Oh, I'm sorry. And see, this is why we have a lawyer here.
A protective order has more teeth than a restraining order, and a protective order is issued by the court when there's family violence.
Okay.
So if there's, that means that actual violence has occurred, that someone's been struck or beaten or harmed in some way physically, or they've been put in imminent threat of danger or harm, a restraining order might be issued for a lesser reason, and it doesn't have the teeth that a protective order does.
So if you're in that situation, then that's, and that's something that I'm assuming that when you go with that, that's something the lawyer has to do, or is that something that somebody files on their own? How does that, I mean, I assume
it,
you want to.
It would be a lot of, a big learning curve for a person to do that by himself or herself. That's usually something an attorney will determine whether there is a fact pattern that gives rise to a protective order or whether a restraining order is more appropriate.
Okay. Okay. So there's a level of expertise there depending on the situation and what evidence is there, I guess is what you're saying. Mm-hmm. Well, and, you know, another thing that struck me was that African-American women have the highest rates of violence within the home, according to feminist.org, and Hispanic women have the lowest rate of violence within the home. Is that a trend that you see here in Dallas, or do you really see more of an even spread across?
I see it more in Dallas County than I do in Collin County or Denton County.
Which is what? I'm sorry, what do you see more?
The spread, the family violence more among African Americans than Caucasians, for example.
Okay.
But I don't think family violence is limited to any one racial group. It's something that can happen to rich, poor, black, white, brown. It doesn't matter. It's across the board.
Well, and one of the things that, you know, we have talked about is just when women are going through these situations, you know, being physically strong, you know, eating well, and just emotionally being able to, I think, find their voice is what you had mentioned. When you're going through this, you have those support systems in place, and you feel like you can, and it helps with the confidence, and it helps with women who, you know, obviously it's a long road. I mean, most divorces take about how long if it's a contested divorce?
If it's an easy-peasy divorce, it might be done in 2 or 3 months. If it's a contested case, there are custody issues and property issues, it might be 1 year to 18 months.
So that, I mean, that is a long time to really have something very stressful and very draining on you.
Absolutely, but that's not necessarily a family violence case. If there's family violence going on in a divorce, and the spouse files for divorce, the battered spouse files for divorce, and a protective order is issued, that's going to get the case settled very quickly because the other party is going to be found guilty of family violence through a protective order. And if there are custody issues, the judges can't give custody to a batterer. If someone's found guilty of family violence in the home, then the battering person cannot be given custody of the child.
But see, something interesting that you were explaining to me when we were talking offline here about custody, and when you do go to a trial, when you are in courts, you know, you said that you have seen in the past where, unfortunately, custody is given to an abuser, if it wasn't proven this is a non-criminal involvement here, only because women, they simply don't do well on the stand. They're not strong enough, maybe emotionally, to be on the stand, and the other person presents, I think was the word that you had used, better. Can you explain the importance of really, you know, having that strength, and maybe a situation or situations in general that you found where that's been the case? And that just seems heartbreaking.
Usually, I'd want to say that usually it's a woman, not a man, who's been battered, but I have had cases where men have been battered by women. Much harder to prove. But when a woman's been battered, she's in an abusive relationship, it's been going on for years or whatever period of time, and there are children involved, I often see that woman she's just at her emotional low. She's just physically and mentally bankrupt and doesn't have any, she's lost her voice and lost her way, lost her identity. So without some help, she's not going to present as well on the stand as the batterer, who will often come off as very magnanimous and very in control and together, if you will, when really the opposite is true. And the judge is only going to have that one snapshot, a superficial view in the courtroom of these two people who are strangers, and make a snap decision.
Well, and that is just, I mean, one, it definitely pains me to hear that. But it brings up something that I'd like to talk about in the next segment here, if possible. And Define Nation, we will be right back with Lisa. We do want to remind you that this segment brought to you by the Highway for Health Project. Childhood obesity and bullying are preventable. They are epidemics, and we can stop them. Visit highwayforhealth.org today. That's highway, F-O-R, health.org.
Hi.
This is Danielle from Define Your Health with Danielle Giordano's Strength Through Knowledge radio show. Something that is near and dear to my heart is the absolute epidemic of childhood obesity in the United States. You know, when I was a kid, my dad used to say, if you're not willing to change something or do something about it, you don't have the right to complain. Well, guess what? I'm doing something about it. The Highway for Health Project is a project to call attention to this epidemic, this preventable epidemic of childhood obesity, to give parents the tools and the resources needed to educate and make the best choices possible for the next generations of Americans. Help me. Help me help the future. Visit highwayforhealth.org today. Again, that's highwayforhealth.org. Today. Highwayforhealth.org. Hey, Define Nation, this is Danielle. And what I learned when buying my first home is trusted experience matters most. That's why I chose Rainbow Realtors. I can't help but recommend them to everyone I meet. Real estate professionals that genuinely put the needs of the client first and surpassing expectations, that's a common experience. Giving back to our military, educators, and first responders is also a priority to them. So don't forget to ask about their Home for Heroes program. Give them a call today at 469-366-4943 or visit them online at rainbowrealtorstx.com. That's rainbowrealtorstx.com. And we are back, Define Nation, with our special guest, Lisa Zahn, who is a board-certified family law attorney, one of the best in Dallas and in the country. And we were really talking about kind of custody and women being able to take care of themselves and really being strong and finding their own voice and how unfortunate situations can occur if they're not able to do that. And it was fascinating to me, a statistic that I found was a third of domestic calls or cases that police were on site for, only a third of them took pictures, which it kind of ties into physical evidence versus just that single snapshot that a judge may have, because we're all human and we can only, you know, judge, no pun intended, on what we see or the evidence that's in front of us. And so do you feel that more physical evidence would help most cases or most people? Because women, you said, are typically the ones that are in a case, but not always.
More evidence always helps. It always helps to have photographs or a police report, an incident report to show the judge. But it doesn't surprise me the statistics that you just read, because women who are in an abusive relationship feel a lot of shame, and they make it their fault instead of the abuser's fault. Mm-hmm. And they want to cover it up or make an excuse. That's what they've been conditioned to do over and over and over. So they default to that and immediately protect the abuser or feel so much shame about being abused in the situation that they're in that they may hide the position that they find themselves in when police respond.
So if a woman finds her, or a man finds him or herself in this situation, typically it is women, what steps do you recommend taking initially? I mean, is it best to get the protective order? Do you find that women or people who are in these situations don't know what resources to initially go to, shelters? Or what would you suggest for a woman or a man listening, anyone in a violent situation?
Well, it depends on whether the family violence has just occurred. If a client came to me and something had just happened the day before or the week before and it was egregious enough to warrant a protective order, I'd recommend getting the protective order as soon as possible. If there'd been ongoing abuse but there had not been an incident for 3 months, it would be difficult to get a protective order. Mm-hmm. There has to be a pattern, but if it's not in a recent history, it makes the burden harder to achieve to get that temporary or permanent protective order. The second thing that I'd say is get some counseling. I offer my clients as many resources as I can, and a good counselor can help somebody a lot, but the client has to be willing to avail herself of the counseling. Mm-hmm. But if you go forward, if she takes that step, that can really help strengthen a woman.
So And I know that we've been talking a lot about parents in custody here, but and also violent situations. But if we can sidestep for just a second, because in a family, there's other dynamics. And a lot of times, grandparents are in situations yeah. that don't really necessarily have to be violent per se, but they're just bad situations where grandparents maybe want to step in and help. For the long-term good of their child that may be in the relationship or the actual grandchild that may be in some sort of danger from neglect or just dangerous situations or if there is violence. What can grandparents do? Do grandparents have rights or what rights do grandparents have? Maybe that's the best way to start.
Grandparents have more rights than people might think. What they do not have a right to do is to get a visitation schedule with their grandchildren. That they do not have a right to do.
So a visitation schedule is something that happens prior to actual a custody ruling?
No, it would be a result of a custody ruling.
Okay.
But grandparents, the cases I handle for grandparents usually occur when the parents of a child have, as you said, neglected a child. Usually it's substance abuse or violence. And grandparents step in to be in the place of the parent to raise the grandchild so they're not in foster care or put into the system.
So how often do you see this kind of scenario play out? Is it more common than we may think?
Absolutely. I handle a lot of grandparent cases and have for years.
So grandparents do have rights, they just have different types of, or they have to go about, the pathway is different, maybe.
Well, a grandparent would have to assert their rights in a lawsuit by filing suit to get temporary custody of a child, okay. and usually do so in order to have rights to make educational decisions, get health insurance, that type of thing. They cannot decide, well, we're not seeing little Bobby enough, so we're going to file a lawsuit so we get to see him every Saturday from 10 to 2. Grandparents okay. do not have a right to do that. But if the parents aren't doing the job, so to speak, mm-hmm. then a grandparent can, they have what's called standing to step in and file suit.
Okay. And so if you are a grandparent that sees a situation that's happening or going on, what first steps? Is it the same as the actual parent that's involved in the situation? Is it reach out to an attorney and find yeah. out details? I mean, or are there other resources out there? What would you suggest if there was a grandparent who they feel helpless maybe on the sideline that they genuinely want to do something for the right reasons?
I think a grandparent would be best served by contacting an attorney. This is not a straightforward kind of case where you could go to forms.com and download a petition and do it yourself. It's much more complicated than that. So I would absolutely recommend a grandparent hiring counsel or just going for a consultation.
Mm-hmm.
I talk to people on the phone every day just because they're not sure whether they have a case or not, or they even want to come talk to me. So just test the waters.
Mm-hmm.
Contact several attorneys and see who might be a good fit and if you even have a case.
I know we talked about violence, and substance abuse is something that you brought up. What other situations, you know, in my personal case, there was a lot of emotional going on as well, too. What is there any other types that people might be saying, well, that's just what he or she does. Well, that's just the way they are. Well,
oh,
you
mental
know what
illness.
I mean? So what have you seen? Can you highlight that just for a quick couple seconds?
Maybe parties who are mentally ill, they may be bipolar and untreated. They may be bipolar schizophrenic. They may be borderline personality disorder. That said, those are diagnoses of people that have been made in my practice, but the diagnoses have been made by qualified mental health professionals, not by me.
So what are the steps if somebody thinks that might be? They need to go to a healthcare professional first in that case.
I think the spouse or grandparent or parent of a person who has these problems should first seek their own counseling with a qualified therapist and get a handle on their own emotions and not enable and learn how to protect themselves and how to navigate the waters. If a child's welfare is at stake, they should absolutely contact a family law attorney.
Okay, well, Lisa, tell everyone how they can get in contact with you. This is obviously a broad conversation that we're having here, and if people have specific questions, what's the best way for them to reach you?
My phone number is 214-387-9056, and my email is lzahn@hqattorneys.com. Lisa Zahn, Lisa, Z as in zebra, A-H-N.
Very good. And people can reach out to you for questions. You are open to that.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Anytime.
Well, it has just been an absolute pleasure. It just seemed like the half an hour just went like that so quickly. But I do think this is a serious topic. I think this is something that, you know, needs to be addressed in so many different scenarios that are playing out, not only across Dallas, but across the country, across the world. And so I genuinely thank you for coming on today. And I thank you for giving of your time and helping folks whom are out there. And Define Nation, do remember that we are going to post a trivia question up on our social media sites for that $500 prize pack. I know you guys love that. We want to thank our friends at Zevia, Kind Bar, Soy Joy, and Nordic Naturals. Until next time, guys, remember, stay motivated, dedicated, and highly recommended. Bye-bye. Hey, Defy Nation, this is Danielle, and when I'm out logging the miles on my bike, eye protection is key. Whether it's thorn grass in New Mexico or the Texas sun pounding down, I trust my vision to Trafossi Optics. Trafossi not only offers superior protection from Mother Nature, but true comfort in their design. Top it off with high-performance style, and you can understand why they have been my only eyewear choice since participating in competitive cycling. Check out their full line of eyewear, including golf, tactical shooting, and water sports at trafossioptics.com. That's TIFOSIOPTICS.com.